Here I am, down on my knees again, surrendering all, surrendering all. Find me here, Lord, as you draw.
Praise the Lord. Amen. We are going to bless these palms that we are having. Yes, I want you to lift them as we bless them. Just lift them up as I say this prayer so that these palm leaves can be blessed for our use. Let's pray. Eternal God, bless these palms and branches to our use. Let these branches be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King and follow him in all the ways that leads to eternal life, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit now and forever. And people say, Amen, amen. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. May I now request all of us to stand up and honor the Lord as we wave our palm leaves once again. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Now turn to your neighbor, just do this. With your palm leaves, greet your neighbor. Yes, don't say curse, but use your palm leaves. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You are all very welcome for this very important service, the triumphal entry, the day that Jesus Christ entered into Jerusalem. As we commemorate this day, we pray that he will be glorified in everything that we do. You are once again very welcome. It's a morning prayer, so we'll continue in prayer. Brothers and sisters, we have come together in the presence of God to offer him praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive his holy word, to bring before him the needs of the world, to ask his forgiveness of our sins, and to seek his grace, that through his son Jesus Christ, we may give ourselves to his service. And if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins to Almighty God, he is faithful and just. He will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You may be seated. I just request that we take a moment of silence as we reflect on our personal lives, as we come before the Lord. Remember that our God is a loving God and is a forgiving God. Let's confess our sins to God. In the same spirit, we shall join in the confessional prayer as we continue in prayer together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our fellow men in thought, word, and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. May the Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall sing your praise. Before we join the worship team, may we all join in the collect. Today is the Palm Sunday, so may we join and say the collect together. Almighty and everlasting God, who of your tender love towards mankind has sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, that all men should follow the example of his great humility, mercifully grant that we may both follow the example of his patience and also be made partakers of his resurrection through the same Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Once again, you're very, very welcome. May we all stand up. We are blessed to have this wonderful team before us that join hymnal choir. Let's put our hands together as we welcome this wonderful team before us, as we join them to worship the Lord today. May God richly bless you.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Let's get onto our feet and praise the name of the Lord with our palm leaves. Those who have them, let's lift them high. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he. name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Hallelujah. Take all the praise, Lord, as you worship and praise you. Hallelujah. Thank you. Father, how we worship and praise your holy name. For you live, and we say that blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Just simply saying, Lord, save. Lord, save us. For you are the King. You are the Lord of lords and the King of kings, and there's none like you. And so, friends, I call upon you to open up your hearts, open up your hands, open up your voices, and just worship this God who has loved us this much. The one who has called us. The Bible says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That he created us in his image. And he's calling upon us to come back to him. That he will save us. And he weeps upon our sins. Much as he weeps upon our sins, he's calling us back to the first love, to continue to know him and do his holy will. Father, we praise you. We glorify your name.
Hosanna in the highest. Let our King be lifted high. Hosanna. We sing Hosanna to the King.
Thank you.
that, sing it from the bottom of your heart and praise the Lord who is good to you. The one who has brought you from wherever you know. The one who has done that thing in your life. The one who has forgiven you and ransomed you by his blood. He's so good in our lives. Because of his mercy, because of his grace, because of what he has done.
Please take your seats. We are going to sing Psalm 24. You can open your Bibles, Psalm 24.
Praise the Lord, church. Good morning. We are going to have our first reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 43, starting from verse 1. Isaiah 43, verse 1. It says, "But now thus says the Lord, He who created you, O Jacob, He who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in exchange of you, because you are precious in my eyes and honored. I love you. And I give men in return of you, peoples in exchange of your life. Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring you offspring from the east and from the west. I will gather you. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons and afar, and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made." Brethren, receive the word of God.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Yee, yee, on Palm Sunday. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Now, this is the song that we have been waiting for. If you do not have a palm to wave, ask your neighbor. I can see my sister there is sadly looking at me, doesn't have a palm. Please ask your neighbor to lend you something so that you can get your palm and raise it, because we are all going to stand up and sing, "Oh, glory, Lord, and honor to the King of Kings." Let us rise and get ready. Get a palm, get something to wave. Amen.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord. You people look nice and expectant as you're looking at me. I feel nice. Okay, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Now we shall have the second reading.
Good morning, church. Praise the Lord. Our second reading is from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 19, verses 41 to 44. Luke, chapter 19, verse 41 to 44. Jesus weeps over Jerusalem. He came closer to the city, and when he saw it, he wept over it, saying, "If you only knew today what is needed for peace, but now you cannot see it. The time will come when your enemies will surround you with barricades, blockade you, and close in on you from every side. They will completely destroy you and the people within your walls. Not a single stone will they leave in its place because you did not recognize the time when God came to save you." This is the word of the Lord.
Glory to the Lord. Praise the Lord. I invite you to rise up and we continue in prayer. Take of this time to glorify the Lord. His Hosanna in the highest. Pray to him and glorify him and bring every burden unto God. Father, in the name of Jesus, our loving and gracious Father, we come before you this morning to give you praise and honor. We come before you, Lord, in your sanctuary, that your name may be glorified. We have come before you, O God, not in our own might. We are not worthy of anything, O God, but we come because you love the world. We come because you sent us your Son, the only begotten Son, to die for our sins. Lord, we give you thanks and come by that mercy before you, O God, that through Jesus Christ, O God, we repent. We repent of our sins, O God. We have done the wrong things. We have a power at work in us that even when we want to do the right things, O God, we find ourselves doing the wrong things. Lord, we have come to repent that in our thoughts, in our actions, and in our words, we have done what we are not supposed to do. Lord, in your mercies, hear our prayers of repentance, O God. We come before you, King of Kings, to pray for this nation, Uganda, to pray that the leaders of this nation may glorify your name, that in everything they do, in the decisions they take, O God, that your name may be glorified. We come before you, God, to pray for the Church of Uganda, that, Lord, you continue to mightily use your servants, O God, to serve you. Lord, we continue to pray that your servants in the Church of Uganda will glorify you, O God, that they will glorify you in the work of serving you, O God, in leading people, O God. We pray that your name may be glorified. We pray for Makerere University and St. Francis, O God, that let people on this hill glorify your name, O God. We pray for the council and other people who take key decisions, O God. We pray for your name to be glorified. As we search for a replacement of a pastor for this place, O God, we pray that the selection will glorify your name. We pray that you will pick a man or woman after your own heart for this place, O God. We pray, O God, we pray for young people in this country, O God. There's a lot going on. There's a lot coming from different places, O God. We pray, O God, that you raise a generation of young men and women that fear you. We raise our prayers unto you, O Lord, that we will have a nation where there is nothing before our nation, no man before our nation, no money before our nation, but it will be a nation of God and our country. We pray, O Lord, that you continue to bless us in this week. You continue to strengthen us, O God, as we reflect about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We give you honor and we give you praise. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Please resume your seats. And let us say the grace together. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever. Amen. Let me invite Reverend Scovia to take us through the notices.
Thank you very much, Philip. Let's appreciate him for his ministry in this place. Thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. And praise the Lord. Today we are going to use this to welcome our neighbors. I want all of us to pick our palm leaves. Do we all have palm leaves? Is there anyone who is not having? Look around. If there's someone lacking, please give to your neighbor. So we are going to greet our neighbors, but we are first of all going to honor God. Amen? Amen? Amen. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Now turn to your neighbor. Use this palm to bless someone next to you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We would like to welcome all of you for this 9 o'clock service, our second service. Thank you very much for coming. And we'd like to welcome our online Christians. You are very welcome to join us. May God bless you wherever you are. Praise the Lord. We'd like to welcome visitors who are here. Do we have any visitor? Yes, kindly put up your hands and we see you and welcome you to St. Francis. You're welcome, you're welcome. Let's welcome them with a hand clap. Yes, you are very, very welcome. Before I put out the notices, with us we have Uncle Peter, the people's warden, and your dear wife. Kindly, Uncle Peter, come and bring greetings to these, your people this morning. Uncle Peter, let's welcome him.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I bring my greetings to you, and I would want first and foremost to also, I think it is appropriate to show you Mrs. Me. Mrs. Me, please kind of stand up. Yes, that is Mrs. Me. Thank you. Yes. Yeah, let me use this opportunity also. This is Mrs. Me for 27 years. Yes. And we are not growing weaker. But we thank the Lord that at a time like this, we can see his mercies and his faithfulness. We just want to wish you a happy Palm Sunday. And next Sunday, a happy Easter, because the two are related. Today we are at the gate of Easter, and on Sunday we will be in Easter. But at the heart of it is the cross. And my prayer is that we shall all find a way to sit at the cross and survey the cross, because that is the heartbeat of our faith. So as we even wait for a shepherd, thanking God for Reverend Scovia and her team, as we wait for the shepherd, we already have a shepherd, Christ Jesus. May his peace be with you. He knows how to supply all our needs according to his riches in glory. So do not be anxious or worried, but in everything with thankfulness, make your supplication known to the Lord. And my prayer for you, this Easter, is that you will see a transaction of the cross in your life. That God will take you from defeat to victory. That God will take you from anxiety to peace, the perfect soul understanding. And he will supply all that you have ever needed according to his riches in glory. Thank you, Hymn No Choir, for blessing us. And I just want us to go. I am reminded of that verse of the hymn, a powerful Easter hymn, which says, when it's when I survey the wondrous cross, but it's the last verse that says, my wife, remind me. where the whole realm of nature mine, that were an offering far too small. And then comes a great line. Love so amazing, love so divine, it will demand my soul, my life, and my all. God bless you.
Thank you very much, Uncle Peter. I am happy today you've introduced Mrs. Yu. Anyone seated with your Mrs. Someone? Yes, yes. Okay, I want you to turn to your Mrs. Someone and look at your Mrs. So-and-so and smile at that Mrs. who is seated next to you. And for those who are not having theirs now, praise the Lord. Just do like this. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Just place your hand here and say, it's well with me. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Yes, you are all very welcome. And all of you are very, very important. Tell your neighbor you are very special and you're welcome for this service. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Before other notices, kindly allow me invite the chairperson of Hymnal Choir to come and introduce this great team to us.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Again, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Our Reverend Scovia has invited me, but there is this lady who claimed that February wasn't enough for them. They took over March and April to be months for ladies again. So let me invite her again to do the introduction.
Thank you, Chairperson. Thank you, people, for welcoming me. Hymnal Choir is so privileged and humbled to be part of the service this morning. And we are always so joyful and so glad to minister with you. And we always look forward to Palm Sunday. Amen? We would like to thank the clergy and St. Francis Chapel for giving us this opportunity to continue ministering with you. I don't know what we would do without, you know, this opportunity. But I was, you know, Feb was our month, and it was our month. And when Reverend told us to look at our people, I was in that category of special people. So all of you in my same category, please wave your palms. Hey, we are many today. Yes, we are there. Okay, so now I would like to introduce the joint hymnal choir, but in the interest of time, we are so many and we are drawn from different churches all over Kampala and Namirembe Diocese. So I would like to ask the people from Kampala Diocese to stand up. From St. Francis Chapel, from which other church? All Saints. Yes, and even St. Luke's Church in Tinda. Yes. Okay, and then the people from Namirembe Diocese, let's all stand up. The majority of the choir is from Namirembe Diocese, including our conductor, our organist. Most of us, I want to relate with them, you know, we are cousins, yes, from Namirembe Diocese, and we are so privileged to be here. And I would like to take this opportunity to invite all of you to join Hymnal Choir. We would like to fill this entire stage and even go down there. Because if you have lips, and you have a throat, and you have eyes, now what is your reason for not joining Hymnal Choir? Tell me, there is no reason. The voice, no, you have the lips and the throat. Ebirada tujagenda mumaso, so we shall practice, and we practice because we would like to join the heavenly choir. Amen. So we always have our practices every Tuesday. Please join us, the young, the old, everyone is welcome to join us, Reverend Scovia. Yes, everyone is welcome to join us. So, I don't want to take your time, and you know I talk a lot given the opportunity. So I would like to hand over back to Reverend Scovia. Praise the Lord.
So how many of us are ready to join this choir? Have you seen the hands? Yes. The youngest is here. Come and take. Yes, the youngest is here. Come. Here. Yes, you give him a hug. Yes. That is beautiful. It's your work to nurture this child, to grow up and make him to be a great minister. Yes.
He was not seen.
Praise Lord.
Praise the Lord. Thank you very much. We are still in Lent season. And we are on day number 34. We are left with how many days? 6 days to go. Clap for yourselves. God has been faithful to us. Amen. We are determined. We shall go to the end. Amen. We shall have public way of the cross on Friday, beginning at 8. We shall all come to the chapel and join the Roman Catholic and begin the march from Freedom Square to all Kampala. That's where we shall be. So we invite you to come as we prepare to walk together. We shall have baptism on 8th. That will be Saturday. So those who have picked the forms, kindly bring them so that we can prepare to have this baptism on Saturday. On Friday, we shall have physical night of prayer. Praise the Lord. On Good Friday, we shall be here and we'll only have one service beginning at 10. Tell your neighbor the service will begin at 10. When you come at 7, you'll be too early. When you come at 10, you'll be too late. So plan well. All the 4 services will be combined and we'll have the wonderful preacher who is before us. That's the Reverend Canon Dr. John Senyonyi, who is here. Praise the Lord. I have not introduced him for now. I am just telling you what is going to happen on Friday, Good Friday. So plan to be there. And today we are blessed to have... That was for Friday. Today we are blessed to have the Reverend Canon Dr. John Senyonyi, who is here, who is the preacher. Let's put our hands together and make him to feel very, very welcome. The former Vice Chancellor of Uganda Christian University. That hand clap is not enough to welcome him. And he has come with Mrs. Doctor, yes, not Mrs. Me, Mrs. Doctor, who is here, who is seated somewhere there. Dr. Ruth Senyonyi, she's a canon, and she has been a provincial Mothers Union president. Let's clap our hands as we welcome her in our midst. Thank you very much for supporting Doctor in this ministry. Praise the Lord. And Doctor will be speaking to us on this very important topic, created for his glory. Tell your neighbor, created for his glory that weep over Jerusalem. So as we are gathered here today, as we celebrate this day, Doctor is coming to tell us more about this. Let's open our hearts to receive from the Lord. Amen. But before he comes, we are joyfully going to bring our gifts to the Lord. And remember, God loves a cheerful giver. May the Lord richly bless you as you give to him.
Almighty God, we thank you, Lord, for these gifts that your children have given back to you. May you accept it, Lord, sanctified by the precious blood of Jesus Christ, and use it to serve your purpose in your ministry. In Jesus' name we pray.
Political. Yes.
Fight the drama.
And flow.
We are in Kampala, stop shouting. When you are in Kampala, especially Makere, you don't shout.
I was still getting in the spirit of
Yes, I know you are in Kampala, but when you are in Makere, you don't shout like that. We are not in that village of yours.
No, Tata Win, where were the people of Makerere when you were selling your land to give your daughter school fees? So people of Makerere should regulate how you get happy because they are in Kampala.
Is that even blowed my gift to my daughter?
Now, where are they? Don't you want a shoe like Tata Precious? Don't you want a shoe like Tata Precious? Let me tell you, Tonzi Jamumwo, I will be happy. Look. Do you remember when Muchivi refused to buy our goat because he didn't want Willy to come to university? Do you remember that? Do you remember when Mauda was laughing that we were educating a girl? Do you remember that? Do you remember when Narongo refused to buy my millet? Rastre, do you remember when you told me to sleep outside because I was giving her the last money for research? Naimba!
Yes, but don't shout.
Naimba, tena atenda.
Don't shout. We are in the Kampala. Yes, you will celebrate, but it doesn't mean that you shout. Ah! You are not in the village.
We are not in the village, but we are ourselves. Okay, you.
Mama Win, you are going to bring problems in the camp. They will arrest you.
Tori Musa, are you not happy?
Oh, Nalongo. How are you? How okay people hey. Have come.
You're looking very smart.
How are you? Thank you for coming. Very smart. Oh, hi, Daddy. You're welcome.
We came with the Reverend.
Hey, how are you? Hey, hello. Praise God. But
me,
now,
I want to sit in front.
Mommy, they only want two people at the Freedom Square. Yeah.
Two people.
Per child.
Oh, okay. Mujetu.
You come.
Two people. Per child.
Yes.
We will tell you, Reverend. You go back. We shall find you at the car. We can't start.
You remain in the car.
Two kids to him. Where is Winnie?
But where is Winnie?
Winnie?
I took her to Winnie.
No. Where is Winnie? She has to hurry up.
If you are Winnie, Vileka, you know that girl has been slow from the beginning. She is very lazy. So I want to sit in front. At least I read the lips.
I thought you were
coming
with Winnie.
Winnie, how are you?
Yes, Baba, how are you?
You put on. Hurry up, me. I want to sit in front. Chila tukende.
Ona shimwa na wa. You go and dress up and you go to...
Yes, Daddy, how are you?
You go and dress up and you go to that.
Daddy,
you won't tell us that you didn't have money for the gown?
You didn't have money for gown?
No, the thing is, you guys are not understanding.
Yes,
yeah? Have you been to your house?
Winnie, you're joking. You're joking, my friend.
I sent you every money
you wanted.
We did have school fees.
Didn't we give you all
when money? When I am putting on Rugabira because I saw it,
didn't we give you the money?
Echkulumuze, you just failed to understand some things. Eh? I have told you that I am no longer going to go to school and I have not studied.
So you are not going to graduate?
That is what I will
do.
So I paid fees for you to come.
Sorry.
And you what?
Wait. I can't.
The way they were even chasing me.
but I don't attend the graduation. Kare, she has graduated. The same applies to us. Instead of making God joyful, we make him grieve for our sins. Thank you.
So it's always better you put on a smile. But it's a joy for us to be here. My wife and I, we came from Mukono, that's where we live. And Kampala is too hot for us. If you come to where we live, you realize how cool it is. The temperatures are always lower than what you have here. But it's a joy for me to be here with Canon Dr. Ruth. Although Reverend Scovia stole my opportunity, I'm going to reclaim it. Please do stand up so that you see the person who has kept me for almost 38 years. We are celebrating 38 in less than 2 weeks on the 13th of this month. So it's a wonderful thing, and today itself is a very special day in the life of our family, because two members of our family, our son, is called John Paul, and his son, who is called Sabelo, are celebrating their birthday today. So you can imagine, it's an amazing thing. They are not in this place, so if you want to sing for them, you will sing virtually, because they live in London. But for us, it's a very, very special thing. God has blessed us with the 4 children. All of them are adults. They're all out of our house. Like I said, John Pan, his family, they live in London. Our youngest lives in Germany. And only some of them live here. So, well, you didn't give them jobs. You did not give them jobs. So they looked for jobs elsewhere. That's what happens, isn't it? That's what happens. But we do have some of our children here in Kampala, and we are very, very proud of them. I think my other pride today is to be in this place together with, now they say Ordinand. You know, Ordinand also became a title of sorts, Ordinand Philip Baitwa. This gentleman here was Uganda Christian University's Guild President. You know, so that is a very special thing for me, to see someone who served with me at UCU and now preparing for ministry. What a joy it is. And so thank you, and may God bless you as you move on with that ministry. The choir, for some reason, I think there has been a rapture. So the sinners are left, the holy ones have left. They've already gone to heaven. But thank you so much for singing for us. I'll just tell you this. In 1965, because you're recruiting singers, where is Grace? She has also left. The Lord has taken many. In 1965, as a young, you know, I was a student already, but I led a song, a Negro spiritual, which was being judged by George Kakoma, for those of you who know that name, composer of our national anthem, and it won. My song won. So I'm something of a singer myself, right? But thank you so much. We are so glad. And of course, also the drama group. Now, there's just one little thing I think that I want to ask you to be in prayer for. As a church, in just over 2 weeks, actually it is about 2 weeks exactly from today, some of us will be traveling to Kigali I don't know if you've heard of what is called GAFCON, the Global Anglican Future Conference, that's the full name. And GAFCON is a fellowship of Anglican churches that decided they were not going to continue with the liberalism that has attacked the Anglican communion elsewhere. So that is very, very important. And this is the fourth conference. The first one was in Jerusalem, then we had one in Nairobi, then Jerusalem, and now we are again on the continent of Africa. It's an international conference, and we have mobilized, the Archbishop appointed me actually to mobilize people, and we have mobilized over 200 from Uganda. We had wanted actually over 400. So who will be going to Kigali for that conference from the 17th specifically. Some of us will be traveling a day before. From the 17th to the 21st. So please keep us in prayer. You know what has been happening in the Anglican Communion, don't you? And so what is happening, you know, the Episcopal Church in the U.S., the Church of England, but there are many, many brothers and sisters in Christ who are standing firm and faithful in those countries as well. And some of those will be with us in Kigali. So keep us in prayer concerning that. Now the topic that I was given to share with you is created for His glory, the weeping over Jerusalem. So I'm going to ask that we pray. The texts were already read, and I will be speaking mostly coming out of Luke and reflecting on the weeping of our Lord Jesus Christ, created for His glory, the weeping over Jerusalem. Dear loving and gracious Father, we thank You for this morning. Thank You for these, Your people, and who have come, who have gathered here. Lord, You wept over Jerusalem, and we pray that today voices will rise out of this congregation who will not make you weep, but rather rejoice because of the work that you are doing in their life. And so I ask that you'll pour Your word in my heart. Speak to me that You may speak through me. And Lord, help us, especially me, to decrease that only You will increase. May all glory return to You in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You know, when you think about it, following the creation of man, God rejoiced. You remember His statement in chapter 1 where He says, He looked at all that He had made, and that included man and woman, and He said it was very good. What happens when something is good? You rejoice, isn't it? So He rejoiced over His creation. He loved what He had made. It was amazing. You go down a few chapters in Genesis chapter 6, and what do you hear? And these are the words that are said there. The Lord saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart were only evil continually. And listen to this sentence, verse 6. And he says, and the Lord regretted that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. So we are talking about created for his glory, the weeping over Jerusalem. Maybe you've never reflected on this, that God actually does weep. Jesus himself wept over Lazarus. And the reason he wept over Lazarus is because he loved him. And he saw, this is God the Son, he saw what the punishment for our sin had brought on his creation, which he never created to suffer sorrow, which he never created to suffer grief, and he felt it himself. and there was grief in his heart. And in John chapter 11, verse 35, we read the shortest verse in the Bible, which simply says, Jesus wept. Just two words. If you've never memorized any scripture, that's a very easy one for you to memorize. And the reason for that is because Jesus loved Lazarus. And the Bible tells us in that same chapter of John chapter 11, he also loved Martha and Mary, the sisters of Lazarus. But the Bible also tells us that Jesus was afar from them, and a message was sent to him, the one whom you love is sick. And the next verses tell us immediately that actually Jesus knew that this sickness would end in death. But it didn't come immediately. It did not come immediately. And we should be thankful he did not come immediately, so that he too may show us he feels what we feel. He wept over Lazarus, whom he loved. Now the passage that we read in Luke chapter 19, verse 41 to 44, has a parallel but slightly differently narrated in Matthew chapter 23, verse 37 onward, where Jesus once again laments over Jerusalem. And listen to the words he uses. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. He lamented over Jerusalem. So that is a parallel kind of text with what we have here. So when we come to chapter 19 of the Gospel of Luke, the first verse there, verse 41, says, and when he drew near and saw the city, he wept over it. So what I want us to reflect on at this moment, first and foremost, is the tears of God. The tears of God. Because we know he weeps. He grieves. He laments. And there is nothing that makes God weep as much as sin. Sin. Sometimes we take it very easily and we just say it's a mistake. We even excuse it and we say, but I'm imperfect. But listen, that excuse does not work as far as God is concerned, as long as sin still remains. The tears of God. The Bible tells us here that Jesus wept. And why did he weep? For the same reason that he wept over Lazarus, who had died, because he loved. So I want to tell you, my brothers and sisters, and there is no way that we can ever say this as clearly as during the course of this week, that God loves you so much that when there is sin in your life, when you go wrong, when you reject, when you push him away, God weeps. Maybe an easy example that I can give you is the story that Jesus told of the father of what we normally call the prodigal son. I prefer not to call that parable the parable of the prodigal son, because I think that parable is about God's love. Now, if you're not familiar with it, you read it for yourself. I'm not going to read it from Luke chapter 15, from verse 11, going down to verse 24. You can read it for yourself. But in that story, we are told of two boys, children of this man. And the man stands for God, as Jesus tells this story. And one of the sons decided to go away from his father. He asked actually for an inheritance. That's not what I'm going to be preaching about. But I'm just trying to illustrate for you the love of God. And he went away. And he wasted all the inheritance that the father had given him. And after wasting it, the Bible tells us he had wasted all this on prostitutes and all sorts of profligate living. And then the Bible says that then he began to be in want. And the next thing that we see, he's feeding pigs, being employed by someone to look at, to feed pigs. And as he looked at what the pigs were eating, he desired to eat what they ate. Until he remembered, in my father's house, even servants eat and they are satisfied. He remembered, what did he remember? His father's love. The only thing that drew him back was the love of God. And when he came back, he had, of course, crafted a wonderful speech of repentance. But his wonderful speech, we don't even know if God listened to it well, but or his father listened to it well. And before he completed it, his father started showering him with the love that he had won. He had already given him his inheritance. He had no right to be in this home. And that's exactly how sometimes we are. That we ourselves, we have gone away from him. As Isaiah tells us in chapter 53. But then, when he came back, there was rejoicing. The father rejoiced. Why? Because he loved his son. And I can imagine that that father, all the time when his son was away, and he had heard the story. Because later on we hear the brother recounting how this boy had wasted everything. So the father knew the story. But it did not matter how much he had lived a terrible life. The father welcomed him back. Why? Because he loved him. He had been weeping, he had been longing, he had been desiring, he had been grieving, he had been lamenting over his son. And that's exactly the kind of love that we are talking about here, that Jesus wept because he loved. The Bible says, as he drew near and saw the city, he wept. Now listen, when the Bible says that he saw the city, he is not talking about, oh, seeing all these buildings. He's not talking about the temple itself and saying, oh, what a wonderful temple. Anyone who has been to Israel, you marvel at the kind of construction that they had. But that's not the reason why Jesus was weeping. It's not the temple that caused him to weep. He was weeping because repeatedly he had come into this city, and each time he came, they rejected him. But these people had decided they were going to rebel against him. They were not going to walk with him. And so Jesus wept. He was not weeping over the buildings. He was weeping over their sin, over their rebellion, over their rejection. That's what brings tears to God's eyes. That's the reason why he weeps. These are people he had created in his image. And Israel in particular, the Jews themselves, had become the elect people that God had said, it's you and through you that salvation will come to everyone else. And he chose them. He loved them. His forefather, their forefather, Abraham, was called God's friend. That's how much he loved them. And what I'm saying to you, my brothers and sisters, God loves you. There is no way you can say it and completely, you know, satisfy anyone. Maybe we can say the cross, but sometimes we have preached the cross again and again, but people still don't understand this love that God has. But this one thing you need to understand. Because he created you for his glory, he loves you. He created you to be the supreme representation of his glory. That's what Isaiah tells us in the text that we read in verse 1 and verse 7. That he created you in his glory, that anyone who looks at you may be able to see the splendor of God. So he wept. He was weeping over their sin. He was weeping over their rejection of this God. He was weeping over people like us who choose sin over coming to him. Listen, friends. I started attending church 9 months before I was born. That's what I did. 9 months before I was born, I was in church. Because you know what? We lived right next to the church. And I remember where my mother used to sit. This was a church of Uganda next to the school that my father headed. And so my mother was always there. My father was always there. And so all the time, she was in church every Sunday. So why wouldn't I be there? 9 months before I was born. But being in church did not change anything about me, did not save me, did not make me a person over whom God rejoices. But rather, I made God weep. I waited a long time. Now maybe you relate to that kind of story. You've been attending church for a very long time. Congratulations. But listen. Attending church without surrendering to him, attending church and ignoring this God, attending church and never surrendering your life to the Lord Jesus Christ causes him to weep just as much as what we are seeing there. So Jesus looked at them. He loved them, just like he loves each one of us. These people were more devoted to their temple than they were to the God that was intended to be worshipped in that temple. Jesus looked at them. People that God had elected, and he had said, "You are my people, and through you the entire earth will be blessed." Jesus looked at them and he said, "I see something that you could have been, but you are not. Why? Because you've chosen to walk away from me." That's what Jesus is saying. Jesus loved. That's why he wept. So when we talk about the tears of God, it's because he loves us. And listen, when it comes to the day called Palms, which we call Palm Sunday, Jesus sat on a donkey. And he started moving toward Jerusalem. And as he moved toward Jerusalem, that's when he wept over it. But listen, something that you may miss, and that I think is very important for you to know, that Jesus was coming into a city that had rejected him again and again and again. And this was going to be the last time that he was entering this city. And so he wept, as he weeps over our sin. As he weeps over each one of us. Maybe your parents were saved. Maybe you have brothers and sisters who are saved. Maybe you do have friends that are saved. But for you are holding out. And what the Bible is saying, Jesus weeps over you. He weeps. You remain unconquered. You remain unsurrendered. You remain walking in the way that you prefer to walk. You see, Jesus weeps because he loves. And let me read for you something that I came across. And is, I think someone did not put his name, but but this is what this person said. Talking about love and talking about grief, I like the way he brought the two words together, grief and love, both sentiments that we have. And this person said that grief is all that unspent love that gathers in our corners, that gathers in a lump in your throat, that gathers in the hollow part of your chest, and you feel truly grieved. And then he concludes and he says, grief is just love without a place to go. Now, I'm sure each one of you, if you're old enough, you know someone that you loved who has died. Right? Many of us do. I have lost quite a few in our family. But I thank God that each one of them left this world having known Christ. I have lost two brothers whom I loved dearly. I've lost my parents, my father, my mother. My mother is the one who died last December. So I've lost these people. And I know how much that remains in my heart like a lump. I know how much I feel it and I think about it and I never stop. And I say, I wish they were here. Because I loved them. Isn't it? You see, when it is something good, like God said, very good, he rejoiced. But when it comes to someone you love and that person goes away from you, there are tears, isn't it? Grief comes out as love in the corners of your tears. So God's grief is essentially love. It's because he loves. When we hear that Jesus wept, he wouldn't have wept if it was someone he didn't want. He wouldn't have wept if it is someone that he did not like. But he wept precisely because he loved. And today, God's grief is love that he wants to give to each one of us. Because he created you for his glory. So he weeps over you for as long as you keep yourself away from him. God weeps. Because he wants to give that love but cannot. Why? Because you will not receive it. Because you refuse. And that's exactly what happened in Jerusalem. But as Jesus came, he was looking at this city and he knew what was going to be happening in a few days, that he was not only going to be rejected, but they were going to give him to the Gentiles. The elect people were going to give him to the Gentiles and we, the Gentiles, would crucify him. He knew all that. But because he loved, he wept. And we can say Jesus wept then. And Jesus weeps even now. But the other thing that is said in this text and also in the one in the parallel one in Matthew is the fact that God gives opportunities. And I want you to look at today and understand that even today God is giving you an opportunity. I do not know how many opportunities he will give, but he's giving you yet again an opportunity to surrender your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what he's doing. So in verse 2 he says, Would that even you, had known on this day the things that make for peace. And in Matthew, he says, you kill the prophets and stone those who are sent to you. How often would I have gathered your children? In other words, God gives the opportunity. And you may have had many, many different opportunities. Why? Because God does not desire any of us to perish. He says in Peter, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, that the Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish. And he says in Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 23, and he says, have I any pleasure in the death of the wicked? Declares the Lord God. Have I any pleasure? Because he does not want. That's why he gives all those opportunities. Isn't that what we heard Jesus also say? I have sent you prophet after prophet after prophet. Listen. I don't know how many times you've been in church. And I don't know how many times you've heard people preach and tell you you need to give your life to Jesus. And each opportunity comes, sometimes you say, oh, well, I'll get saved. You're good. You're saying something good. You want to be saved. Others just say, well, it's not for me. I have even heard people who say, saved is for some people, but for me, I'm a Christian. Can you imagine? And I usually ask them the question, so if you're a Christian and you're not saved, what did Jesus come to do? What does he say he came to do? To save sinners. Isn't it? I'm reading what he's saying. That's what Jesus says. We give every excuse with every opportunity that's given us. I have even known people who have postponed it and procrastinated about it for years on end, and God keeps on coming and keeps on coming, like Jesus came to Jerusalem and wept over them. And the problem, you don't know how long that will last. So I want you to reflect on the opportunities God has given you to know his love, the opportunities that he has given you to hear the gospel, the opportunities and the many other things where he has delivered you, and he has said, I have not yet saved this person, and he's given you all these opportunities. But with each opportunity, you've pushed him away. You know, when we preach like this, it's because God has sent us. God is not going to come. If you think some people, you know, give testimonies and thank God for that, they get dreams, they get visions, then they get saved. But listen, you are sitting in church, so what are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? Jesus lamented. And I think he would lament even today. Oh, St. Francis, St. Francis. You may say, no, we've never killed any preacher. But you see, the worst kind of killing for a preacher, for a teacher, is when they say what they say and they invite you to do what you should do and you still say, no, I'm not going to take it. That's the best way to kill. Because I don't mind. I mean, for me, I know where I'm going. That matter was settled in 1976. Yeah, as a university student. It was settled once and for all. So for me, I know where I'm going, but do you? Do you know where you're going? So Jesus weeps. He says, I sent you. You kill the prophets. You stone those who are sent to you. You keep them going away, and you don't care to respond to the message that they bring from me. And he says, how often? You have had all the opportunity, but you do nothing. There are many others that don't have as much opportunity as you have. And so Jesus says, I wish you knew the day of your visitation. But he says it with grief. That's why the Bible here tells us he wept. He wept. And Jesus weeps over your lost opportunities. Now, as I come to the conclusion, I want you to understand something else. This was the last time that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. Essentially, what is happening here, and this time he came on a donkey, and there are those who waved the palms, who later on shouted on Good Friday. It wasn't good, by the way, but they shouted on Good Friday and they said, crucify him, crucify him. So what is it that was happening? Jesus was making his final appeal when he came on Palm Sunday. He was making his final appeal. And he was saying, this is it. In him, God was making that final appeal. Just like we read. And he says in Luke chapter 11, verse 45-52, you have killed them from the time of Abel, from the blood of Abel to the blood of Zechariah. You've been killing them. You've been rejecting the message. And he says, now I'm appealing to you for the very last time. The question is, will you listen? There's a story that is told in the very next chapter, chapter 20, by Luke, where a man had a vineyard, and he let it out to tenants. And the Bible tells us when the vineyard had fruited, he kept on sending servants to go and bring him some of the fruit. But each time they went there, they were rejected. Some were beaten, others were killed. Until eventually he said to himself, now I will send my son. And so he sent his son. And you know that story? He's talking about God's final appeal. He's actually saying, now I will send my son. Maybe they'll respect him. Because no longer am I sending servants. I'm now sending Jesus. And he's saying, what will you do with him? And son appeal is the final appeal. Because he created you in his image for his glory. And he's saying you may never hear it again. So the question that comes to us, what will you do with God's final appeal? And I'm going to give you an opportunity to respond to that. What will you do with God's final appeal? Because he's saying to you, there is no other chance. Actually, the writer to the Hebrews, if you've never read the book, the letter to the Hebrews, you better read it. Because the letter to the Hebrews specifically says that those former times are forgiven. He has now sent the Son, and please expect no other salvation. None whatsoever. And that's what he's saying. So the question that I'm asking you, will you go give God the joy of knowing that you're surrendering to him? Or must Jesus weep again that yet another day someone has said, no, I'm not going to receive you? That's what he's asking us. You see, Palm Sunday was an opportunity. And if you follow that story, you soon realize that when he entered Jerusalem, overturned the tables, and all that he did, he was again rejected. Now the plot thickened until they arrested him and eventually handed him over to be killed. So this is the final appeal. And I do not know, you know, I'm speaking as one who has experienced the love of Christ. And for me, there's no greater joy than to know that Jesus is in my heart. 1976, as a young university student, he saved me. And when he saved me, I've never looked back. So I'm going to give you an opportunity. And here is what I'm going to do, very simply. I am going to pray. And in the middle of this prayer, I'm going to give an opportunity for any person. If you're saying, I want to give my life to Jesus, wherever you are, some of you are in the gallery, others of you are down here, but I'm just saying there is a prayer that I'm going to pray that I will ask you to repeat after me. If you're willing to give your life to Jesus, if you're willing to make God enjoy your presence once again. So let us pray. Loving Father, we thank you so much for this morning, and we thank you for the words that you have brought forth. We are unworthy even to proclaim your name, but you give us this opportunity that your people may be turned over to you. And so I ask, Holy Spirit, now, may you send out invitations, touch each of these people whom you have loved so dearly, and bring them to the knowledge of Christ. And so, friends, if you're willing to give your life to Jesus, I'm going to ask you to repeat this prayer after me. Pray these words, please. If you're willing, you're praying to God, you're not praying to me, it does not matter what words you use, but I'm asking you to repeat these after me. If you're willing to give your life to Jesus. Dear Father, thank you for speaking to my heart. I thank you for yet another opportunity. You have loved me. You created me for your glory. I have caused you grief. But now I cause you grief. I surrender my life to you. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Make me your child. And fill me with your Holy Spirit, that I may confess you before all, that you are my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me now very quickly do one little thing. If you've prayed that prayer, I thank God for you. Now, Paul says in Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, that you do two things to be saved. First thing you do is to believe, which is something that happens between you and God secretly. But the second thing he says, you must confess to be saved. In other words, you need to do something that enables others to know you have been saved. And so I'm going to ask you, if you've prayed that prayer, or maybe you didn't pray, but you're saying, yes, I want what you've been talking about. Just put up your hand and say, yes, I have. We need to do this quickly. Put it straight up. Yes. God bless you. God bless you. I can't see those hands. Others, even upstairs, God bless you. God bless you. Any others? Now I'm going to ask those of you who are putting up your hands, stand up. Stand up, please. Let's do this quickly. Time is gone. Just stand up quickly. You are responding to the love of God. You're not responding to me. It's because God has loved you. No, don't sit. Stand up. Keep standing, please. Because I'm going to ask you actually to make your way. Give them way, please, so that they can come out quickly. Just come out and come over here. Come over here. This is a public confession. You're saying yes to Jesus. I think it's better if you stand up there because people are seated very close. Just stand up on the platform. Let's come from upstairs, please. Let's come very quickly so that we don't waste any time. You know that you have given your life to Jesus. This is an amazing opportunity for you to declare publicly. You know, I remember one time preaching in Egypt. We are still waiting for people coming from outside, from upstairs. Preaching in Egypt, where you could not make that kind of public confession easily. But people did. We found other ways. Because in every church where I preached, there were intelligence officers at the back. And every time I finished preaching, they would come and question the pastor. You know, and I did not want to put these, we did not want to put these in danger. But what a joy it is to welcome you, my dear friends. What a joy. In the Gospel of Luke that I referred to in chapter 15, verse 7, 10, it says this. There is great joy over one sinner who repents. One. Right? It says in heaven. Actually, I like it. In Luganda, it's even better because it talks of pure joy. Joy that is without an alloy, if you wish. So in heaven, over one, there is joy. Now, can you imagine what's happening in heaven? Can you? Praise the Lord. But that does not take away the fact that they are rejoicing for each one of you. It's not just about a group. No, no, no. Each one of you. So thank you very much. Let me invite Reverend Scovia, kindly, if you want to say something to them before you go back. Yesu.
Nasiza Devasa Omulokozi.
Let's clap our hands to the Lord for this great harvest. Thank you very much. Let's appreciate Dr. John for the wonderful sermon. Let's clap our hands to the Lord for using him. And then also, we receive these people. Let's clap our hands as we receive them. Thank you. Thank you very much. This is the best decision you've made in life. And you'll always remember this day. Thank you very much. You are kindly going to fill these cards. And after the blessing, we have a discipleship tent outside here. So we invite all of you to come so that we can help you to grow together. Once again, you're very welcome. Thank you for making this very important decision for yourself. God bless you. You may kindly now go as we conclude this service. Praise the Lord. Thank you very much. God bless you. May I invite the choir to come before the Canon comes to give us blessing. And as they come, Holy Week begins tomorrow, and we shall be having morning devotions as usual, then prayers every evening beginning at 5. We invite all of you to be part of it.